Good afternoon, everyone. In today's video, I'd like to go through the results of our squeeze signal scan. The squeeze signal is an indicator that we've built to really help us identify stocks that are likely to start to make a move up higher, a momentum type move, based off of not only the squeeze, but a few other conditions as well. So the first stock that we'll talk about is the Fidelity Real Estate ETF. So you'll notice that there's a pattern here that comes out today, which is really a bunch of real estate ETFs that came onto our squeeze signal scan, which again is really interesting based off of what happened earlier in the morning where Jay Powell came out, mentioned that they're going to be targeting an average of 2% inflation. So you start to expect certain sectors starting to be a bit more bullish, but let's say you didn't necessarily understand what inflation means, the economics of it doesn't make too much sense. That's where just using pure technicals and looking for patterns starts to become a very interesting strategy to start to fill in the missing gaps of what does the market think is likely to start to trend higher from here. So the first thing that stands out is our real estate ETS. So we had a couple different stocks or ETS rather that met the criteria here. The first was the Fidelity Real Estate ETF. You'll notice we had two squeeze signals here, almost back to back. We had them one day, then we had really a down day, and then today again, another squeeze signal, which to me implies that we're now starting to break up higher. If we take a look at just our fibs, our swing high to our swing low here, you'll notice that this is the third time we're going to be touching the 618 retracement, which again, I would hope that from this point, using really the momentum in your favor, we would break past 2480 and then start to make a move towards 27.05. So that starts to become a really interesting trade here, and if we just look at the longer term, and this is really long term, that's where the 1272 takes us to 33.55, which starts to become a really interesting tradable type of move, both to 27.05, as well as retesting previous highs at 29.91, as well as then really making an extension to 33.55. So stocks that haven't really taken off yet already made some obscene type moves. That's where the real estate ETF, I would imagine, is now starting to catch up. Now let's just go down the line here. So the next stock we had was Fortress Value. That's where this isn't too interesting, not enough data for us to have any sort of edge here. So let's keep going down the line. The next one was General Mills. Fairly interesting, a CPG type stock, right? A consumer product good. And that's where General Mills, we had our first squeeze signal here. And then we had really a whole lot of chopping sideways. You can consider this a down move, but really for all intents and purposes, for if we take our trend line tool here for what? That's close to... Actually, whoops, let's take our trend line tool and then let's measure. This is almost 45 days. We've just been chopping sideways. Now we had our second squeeze signal along with an edge signal, all starting to imply to me that, hey, General Mills may be starting to take off as well with that resistance being at 65.28. But if we can clear that, then the 1272 takes us to either 67.23 as well as a larger swing term extension of 1618 here. That's this swing high to this swing low if I can collapse this. That 1618 takes us to... right around that 68.11 zone. So that starts to become a really nice cluster that, again, starts to become a tradable move anywhere in between here if we do start to see General Mills start to take off. Now coming down, we see International Paper. And International Paper, we had, again, two squeeze signals here along with a bullish market pulse line, which leads to a bullish bias here. However, in IP, the options here are fairly liquid, but if we take a look to try and see if there's any clues here, we'll collapse the one day to expiration. But now if we come out to something like 8 days, you'll notice 1626 open interest towards that 38.50 mark. Keep coming down to the actual monthlies in September, and that takes you again to the 37.50. And then if we come out 50 days out, you'll notice a good amount of open interest here that starts to extend even beyond 37.50. Coming back to our charts here, 37.50 is really close to where we are, and so that's where the option chain doesn't give us something too exciting. However, if we keep going down the line here, the next one we had was IYR, which is the iShares Real Estate ETF. Again, very similar pattern as well, right? We had two squeeze signals earlier, led to a fairly nice move, then chopped around sideways. Now we have another set of two squeeze signal indicators coming up. We've cleared the 1618 in IYR. And that's where the next target would be 84.42. And if we can break that, as well as the previous highs right around that 86 mark, then 90.03 starts to become a really interesting target as well, where you're finding an opportunity to find stocks that really have yet to have that explosive type movement. And here we see multiple times the real estate ETF coming out. I'll skip one real quick to, I think it's the... VNQ here, that's the Vanguard Real Estate ETF as well. And so just to kind of conclude this theme of real estate, you'll notice something similar as well. So we have three different stocks, all of which hit our squeeze signal scan here. VNQ, which is the Vanguard ETF, the iShares ETF, along with the Fidelity ETF, all in the real estate sector, suggesting that we have a bullish move up higher. So I thought that was the first interesting thing. Now let's come back. We had RL. Ralph Lauren doesn't look all that interesting. We have our squeeze signal here, but for our market pulse line, which is just a very quick indication of the trend, we see that for the most part, we're on a bearish trend. So this doesn't doesn't look all that interesting compared to elsewhere where we see a green market pulse line. If I contrast this with IYR, you'll notice that for the most part, our market pulse line here is either green to gray. Keep coming down the line here. We had Cohen and Steers quality. Not too sure what these people do, but if we take a look at just pure technicals here, you notice that we have our squeeze signal. We have a bullish market pulse. However, for the most part, the stock has really just been chopping sideways. And so that's where hopefully you'd be looking at the squeeze signal to start to take you up above this previous high. But really, an $11.35 stock, nothing too interesting here. Keep coming down the line. The next one is Univar Solutions. Univar, we're a little bit extended from our market pulse line than what I think I would prefer to be. However, again, if you see for the most part chopping sideways, and if we can take out these highs right here, now that we have the squeeze on our side along with some momentum, that's where targeting the previous highs here, seeing if we can get a retest at 24.77, starts to become a move in which your risk to reward makes a whole lot of sense. Now, if we keep coming down the line, the next stock we had was Veeva Systems. Veeva Systems has really had a massive tear where here I wouldn't necessarily say that there's much of an edge. You'd be getting into an extended type movement where strategies like either the butterfly or getting a one-to-one risk reward using options at the bare minimum starts to become more interesting than trying to really participate using the actual stock or anything that requires a huge amount of capital outlay. And then finally, we already covered VNQ. Let's go through Walmart. Walmart had a substantial move today, especially considering what it's typically been seeing. Right, quiet for the most part for the past almost what? If we take our trend line tool here, this was close to almost 45, 46 days until we finally saw an explosive type movement. Again, very little edge here when we've already hit our 1272 extension. That would have been our first target. For those of you that are again looking to be a bit more aggressive on Walmart, that's where the 1618 cluster here between 141.20 and 143.50 starts to become fairly interesting for either out of the money call spreads or for butterflies targeting or a pin right around either, like, say, the 142, 144 zone or even multiple butterflies that have wider widths. So those are the stocks that hit our squeeze signal scan, the stocks that we think are likely to start to take off. Now, I know this video has already gone on a little bit longer than we'd like, so let's just quickly cycle through all of the futures market charts here. So if I come in, let's go ahead and collapse the watchlist pane here. Let's just start with the S&P, and I'll start with our doomsday aggressive models here. That's where we were originally on the S&P. You'll notice in that 9 to 10 a.m. Pacific hour, when the charts load here, we had really price action almost throughout the board start to really have an extensive amount of volatility. Now, the thing that I'd like to call out here, as opposed to focusing more on the breaches or the trade mechanics, is the patterns that we had early on in the morning. This is at 7 a.m. Pacific. We knew that the S&P was on the doomsday aggressive models. We knew that the Dow was on the doomsday conservative models. And in the meantime, whereas we have both of these markets on the doomsday charts, the NASDAQ and the Russell were on just their regular aggressive model charts. Now, contrast this with ZB, where we saw a huge amount of volatility, and this is something we don't usually see, where ZB, the 30-year bond, even on our doomsday conservative model, if that loads in, we broke through even that cloud before 7:30, which is when I sent out the note to all of our members. And so this was a clue where, hey, while we do see that the S&P and the Dow are on their doomsday models, which really suggests higher volatility, the NASDAQ and the Russell have yet to catch up with that volatility being on the aggressive models. And so that was something I included in the notes, particular with just the NASDAQ, where we expected the volatility in NASDAQ to continue to increase when you see that really the market is giving you all the signs, or at least clues, if you think about it that way, with the S&P, the Dow, and the 30-year. Now let's keep cycling through and just go through the energies here. So natural gas, right, had a fairly substantial move as well, where we have to be on our doomsday conservative models. If we look at copper, again, in that 6 to 7 a.m. Pacific hour, we saw a huge amount of volatility. And then crude, if I come to crude here and we zoom out, same sort of thing, right? So really the theme today is, given the morning's activity, especially with Jay Powell's statement, we saw that volatility trickle down really across all 10 of our futures market charts. We had markets like gold and silver where we already knew right off the bat we weren't even interested in trading them, considering that we had broken past our volatility box clouds, really making them look like a sandwich. That's where the clouds really invert here. The orange is above the green. That's usually what happens when we have greater than usual volatility. When that's happening on even our most conservative models, the doomsday conservative models, which really do a a fairly decent job of at least containing even the volatility in the metals as of recent. That's where even when that's broken, we don't really have an edge here. We know to sit out on the sidelines without really needing to put a whole lot of capital at risk. And then finally, I'll contrast this with silver, where gold today was clearly more volatile than silver, right? If we take a look in gold, the clouds had really completely collapsed, whereas in silver, we saw that we still broke outside of the clouds, but you had some sort of structure there. So this should hopefully give you an idea of not only how you can use the patterns, how you can use all the information, the clues that we have by 7:30 a.m. Pacific when we send out that note, and use that to try and at least not predict per se, but have a better idea of what to expect as the day goes on. The whole idea is really to pay attention and just really start to observe the patterns and the clues that the market is giving us, especially when you can start to use these models as a scale of relative measurement across futures markets. All right, hope this video helps. Hope the earlier scans give you an idea of at least some particular places where you may be looking at trying to participate. The real estate sector is the one that I think stands out the most to me, and one that I'd be looking at to try and play bullishly, as well as looking at these volatility clues, especially as the week progresses, to try and see if we have a better idea of what happens, especially with the morning activity. All right, take care, everyone. Good luck trading tomorrow. For those of you that are trading options, again, we have Friday coming out where the one day to expiration option gives us that really unique benefit of the risk to reward. If you haven't already, take a look at some of our previous videos if you are looking to try and play that, and we'll see you in the next update. Take care.